we will reinvent the processor. Starting with a basic calculator and step by step we will transform it into the CPU. In the beginning we have this thing. As I said, it can do only arithmetics. And we have some storage for numbers and results. 16 cells, each one is 32 bits long. The name for the cells is registers. The instruction looks like this. The name of the operation, result register, first term, second term. And the finishing touch would be the instruction to move numbers between registers. Move instruction. This is our starting point. You may be wondering, why do we have only 16 registers? Can we have more? Not really. Silicon space is a bit limited and operating system will not be happy handling thousands of registers. So for extra space, we need a separate piece of hardware. Such hardware is called memory. For the CPU, memory is just a very long array of bytes. The word array is very important. It means that all the bytes are numbered and each byte has its own address. Having that, we can access the exact byte we want. To work with memory, we need only two operations, load and store. Load is from memory to the register and store is the other way around. And instruction itself looks very straightforward. We should specify the register and the memory address. And that is how we work with memory. Time to invent the machine language. We want to encode this instruction in the best way, and the best means using the least number of bits. First, how to encode a single register. 1 bit for 2 registers, 2 bits for 4, 3 bits for 8, and 4 bits for 16, so we need 4 bits. To encode the operations, we do the same. This code is for multiplication, that one is for division, and so on. More instructions we have, more bits it takes to encode a single one. Right now we don't have a lot of operations, but considering future, maybe we can just take 6 bits for the operation code. Very soon we will need extra bits, and 18 actually doesn't really sound computer science-y, so let's make it 32. As a quick summary, let's assemble this one. We have to fill each bit of 32. 6 bits for the operation code, 4 bits for destination register, 4 bits for the first term and 4 bits for the second term. And other bits are unused for now. I was a bit inaccurate about load and store. Load instruction is encoded with 32 bits as well. 6 bits for the load operation code, 6 bits for register to load to, and we have only 22 bits left. But the address could take up to 32 bits itself. We don't have enough bits. What we can do is to adjust the instruction a little. Instead of having the address as part of the instruction, we will put the address to another register and use it. Instead of 32 bits of the address, we need only 4 for the register. As a summary, with such encodings, we now can tell the CPU what to do, where to get the arguments and where to put the result. We are finally at the point when we want our CPU to actually do something. Now we can put some instructions right into the memory and ask the CPU to execute. One small thing, instructions in binary form are too difficult to read. Let's write exactly the same instruction but in hexadecimal. This is much better. Now we put instructions into the memory and the CPU is ready to execute. R15 is now responsible for tracking the currently executed instruction. The CPU will update this R15 each time it goes to the next instruction, and it happens automatically. Let's give R15 a proper name, it will be called Program Counter. Now let's execute all the instructions and see what happens. Summary, the CPU can execute all the instructions one by one from memory, and we have a special register to track the address of the current instruction. Time for if-else. First, we need the instruction to compare R6 and 100. We also have true branch, else branch and the code outside. And instructions to jump. jump not equal, and a regular jump. Let's see how it works if R6 is equal to 100. In that case, the jump not equal instruction doesn't really jump anywhere, and we execute the next instruction. When the first branch is done, we want to jump outside of the if-else. That's why we have this jump instruction. If R6 is not equal to 100, we jump to do something else part. With that done, the execution of the rest of the code goes in a natural way, proceeding to the next instruction. How to design the compare instruction? If you look at it, it doesn't have any argument where to put the result. Instead, the CPU has a special condition flags place, just a few bits. Equal bit, greater bit, and less bit. Each time any compare instruction is executed, the CPU writes these three bits. What we can do with these bits is to tell any instruction not to be executed if some of those bits are set. Let's put this idea into jump instruction encoding. 3 bits for condition check, 6 bits for the operation code, and the rest for the jump offset. Let's see how it works. Compare instruction finds out that R6 is equal to 100 and the CPU sets the equal conditional bit to 1. Jump not equal instruction is supposed to jump only if the equal conditional bit is not set, but we have it set to 1, so the CPU doesn't jump. We proceed to the true branch. When true branch is finished, we jump outside. Do we need something extra to make a loop? No. First, we put 0 into R7. Each iteration, we want to increment R7, compare it to 100, and do one more iteration. It is important to do it in exactly that order. But the very first iteration is a bit special. We don't want to increment R7, but we want to keep the comparison. And with this jump, we are skipping the first increment. Jump less equal instruction will bring us to the loop body each time R7 is less or equal to 100. And this is our loop iteration. When R7 becomes 101, jump less equal instruction is not executed and we go outside of the loop body. To sum up, with compare instructions, we can support if-else and loops. Let's recall what we've done. We started with a very simple thing, with arithmetic operations and 16 registers. The first thing we added was memory, and we need only two operations to work with it, load and store. Next, we invented 32-bit instruction encoding. These 32 bits have all the information, what operation to do and what registers to use. After that, we put such instructions into memory and the CPU can execute them one by one. And we introduced compare instruction and jump instruction. Having them, we can do if-else and loops. What we've done is enough to cover a very significant part of the machine code. Look at this, the real machine code. It was built for 32-bit ARM. We are now familiar with almost everything you see here. All the operations we discussed. Arithmetics and moves. Load and store. Compare. Jump instruction is called branch in ARM, so instead of jumps, you see Bs. Here is branch and branch not equal. As we discussed, each instruction is placed in memory. You see the memory addresses. And each instruction has its 32-bit encoding, and what we invented is really close to the real machine. This is load instruction encoding for ARM. They also encode each register with 4 bits, they also have operation code, and they even have condition check bits. Wonderful, real machines are that simple. What we haven't discussed is how to make a function call. And these magic things are about that. Watch my next video if you want to break them down.